Interesting.
Good evening. Welcome to The Face of Friday Night. Peter Kibazo, your host. An interesting one to start. We should have a full table. Some people have abdicated for reasons that along the way you will be able to understand. I'll start by introducing Dr. Arthur Bainom Jisha joining the table this evening. Welcome, Arthur.
Thank you, Mr. Chiwazo, and good evening, viewers.
Right, and Charles Romshana.
The Almighty God is great.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Right, viewers, today we will put our hands in a bit of a hot pot. Within this region, especially the Great Lakes region, there has been a time when we all looked alike in terms of war, with the exception of Tanzania and Kenya. Rwanda, Burundi, the Congo, go further down. If you start with wars of independence, you will do Zimbabwe, you will do Namibia, you will come upwards all through. The Rhodesians were rather a bit docile and peaceful in spite of their wars of independence. When you come into the Congo, we've never quite gotten away from there. Then you go up the whole range of the Congos with the Guineas and come back to the Sudan, now Somalia. There is one characteristic that is permanent. There is no peace in those areas. And today, as we join Arthur here, Arthur and as a code, not as Arthur, Arthur is the executive director.
Yes.
At Accord. Okay, actually, let me be really very, very courteous with Arthur. Arthur, the Friday show is a rather casual show where people say it the way they feel it. Dr. Arthur Bainomgisha is the executive director at Accord. I've done the service of the introductions. Mm-hmm. Now the gloves are off. Arthur Bainomgisha's Accord and Bradford University has been running a program on peace. Why war in Africa? Mm-hmm. And we're going to delve into that. This afternoon at the Serena conference hall, there was that discussion, why war in Africa? And we should have been joined by my friend Felix Kulaije, mm-hmm. Kano now,
yeah.
To inquire into war in Africa. And my friend Norbert Mao, whose child is indisposed and therefore unable to be here as well. Mm-hmm. Why war in Africa? Mao shares a very good experience. He was part of the team that negotiated with Joseph Kony. Mm-hmm. Whichever way you look at it, it is an opportunity that not very many people receive. It is like
it was his war.
It is like seeing the Virgin Mary. Not everyone does. We talk about her. So Mao saw Joseph Kony.
They hugged,
shook hands, took pictures, and he possibly knows why Joseph Kony was in the bush. Charles, I'll start with you. This program is running for peace in Africa, but it asks the question, why war in Africa? And before you look at the broader Africa, I want you to start with home, the Great Lakes region. Mm. If someone asks you, why does total peace elude the Great Lakes region in Africa in the past 20, 15 years? Because after the wars of independence, we thought that we had got the coups of Africa that brought in, Patrice Lumumba and that generation of leaders. After they had been toppled by generals, we went into the next, what we called the second liberation in Africa. Students of history and politics study that. The second liberation, where the generals were thrown away, and yes, we will be joined by a general. When the generals were thrown out of power, and we got the second set of generals. The second set of generals was a liberative set of generals. We even named them, we baptized them. We didn't. The British did. They baptized them, the new breed of African leaders. One of them has already gone to his maker. The others are still around. Charles, why war? Starting with this region.
Yeah, of course, as scholars say, war is the highest.
I'm not one of them.
I'm a teacher. War is the highest form of struggle to resolve contradictions if they can't be resolved by any other usual means. If they have gone beyond resolution by any other usual means, any other usual means, then it's war. Like, for instance, this contradiction, which is in Nambori, the Nambori contradiction, the collapse of the rural consensus, the emergence of the family consensus, the ejection of one of the families, now living one family and a half. And so it's a consensus. It's not following the other agreed rules.
When you talked about Nambole, I actually thought of the football match in
Nambole. No, and I'm talking about this confusion going on in NRM. Now, to resolve, if all the other means of resolving this contradiction fail, not necessarily a primary contradiction, this is a secondary contradiction. If it fails, then the only available alternative would be war. So there have been contradictions. Okay. In other words,
I am sure you haven't been a student of psychology like I am. For us students of psychology and human development, we know that always it is the basest form of humanity that will return to war. If you see humans not able to sit, if you see them flexing muscles, they've gone back to their animal instinct. So you're saying for you that if we can't resolve the first level, we become animals.
Oh yeah, because you see the
isn't that primitive?
The crab, I mean, the crab you have is not the best. The civil mechanism, the civil system, the civilized system brings you the best. So you would have the Asabi Romujishas, who are doctors in management, but they can't afford to be beaten on the streets. So the Public Order Management Act, as I will read it and would even seek interpretation, and where you find that the problem with it, you wouldn't go on the streets. Then you would have a person who wouldn't fear that go on the streets. So the situation produces that kind of group of people that cannot use other peaceful means in resolving conflicts. Now, for instance, we had kingdoms here in the region. Mainly, this region was held together by kingdoms. But these kingdoms were repressive, and they had ethnic minorities as in charge of these kingdoms. So, and most of them were overthrown violently. Like, for instance, the Tutsi group in Rwanda. Now, here, it comes in and it allies with another minority, who are cattle keepers, scorers of them, the Dr. Asabi Nomcha type, call them the Hima. Now you have a Tutsi-Hima alliance, and it has a consensus in Rwanda. How does it spread out? Capture of state power here, using it as a facility to extend to Rwanda, and Mobutu ends up as a victim. So you have a war exported, but having emanated from Rwero. But if you ask President Museveni, and I have had have listened to his submissions and lectures on it, Habyarimana was saying the grass is full. You see, he described him by names. The grass is full. But how were they ejected? They were ejected. The Kagames and the Rwigemas of this world, they were ejected to create room in the grass, and it feared. Now these ones went in and displaced them. And as of now, again, the grass is full. So talks of recommendations of President Chikwete, Tanzania, that you talk cannot be listened to.
Just hold on there. Let me ask you. Because you put two things at the same time. One is the ethnic tension within the region. So is why war would you answer with ethnic tensions, or would you answer with population pressures? Because those are two different things. You may have a population pressure and you are unable to accommodate yourselves. And
you see, the problem was not.
So is it ethnic?
The problem was not land. The problem is that you have a minority which has been armed, and it's dominating the majority, a huge group of people who are more than they are because they possess weapons. Like, for instance, as it was in Burundi. It went on for a long time, and now you have a contradiction of wanting to dominate the community using a minority who is armed, and at the same time wanting to practice democracy. Now, the moment you go democracy, then this group is threatened, and it resulted in Dadaye, if you remember Dadaye in Burundi. So the problem had been resolved through democratic means. It produced in Dadaye, and Dadaye had to be killed. So and they went into another round of war until they had external pressure that has created this kind of temporary situation that you have in the same case of in Congo. They couldn't resolve the M23 problem peacefully.
They couldn't resolve the RPA, Abiyarimana contradiction peacefully. So you had two heads of state skilled from a peace mission. They had come from signing a peace accord in Arusha, but they were killed. So it was not implemented. Now, those who left, who had said the grass is full, want to come back, and those who are around are saying the grass is full. And you remember, we had a conversation how all their properties were rooted. That even if they were to come, what did this time you were?
Ndaifashi. I have captured it.
You find someone's property, you have captured it. That is the basis of the revolution. Kill and capture property. And the other group also wants to come back.
Just you make these revolutions really petty, you make them
but
seem
they are
ideologically empty completely. It is about grabbing, it is about ethnic existence. None of these do I feel is ideological. Actually, I would feel the issue of population pressure and the resources being put on pressure. The other ones seem petty. We can't be fighting over those petty things in the Congo, in Burundi, in Rwanda, in Uganda,
but even
in Central
Somalia,
in Central Africa Republic.
Because you see, the leaders are looking at alliances of ethnic groups. Look at the construction in Kenya. You have the one ethnic group, or call it the tribe of the current president, the Chikuyus, allying with another one. And to dominate and exclude, because it's winner take it all. Exclude the other one, and at 49%, the other one has 51%, and it can't go on like that when it has the backing of the military. So you have a problem. Actually, who is joining us has just said that they won't allow an illiterate president take over.
You do not introduce my guest.
No. I have read somewhere that is because I also have my rule that I'm monitoring. His official statement is that the UPDF will not allow an illiterate president, an illiterate army officer, to take over. But we're in a democratic dispensation. Why are we worried about an elite?
I think that's out of context. Maybe.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm showing you already the minds to resolve the contradiction.
I was there, so I think that's quoted out of context. But I will explain it when the time comes.
I'm talking about what is on record. And here I hear from the one who has made the record, which is the TV. So it shows you the mindset. But already there is a contradiction. I'm raising what is on TV, and you say, but it can't be. And normally, the statements are withdrawn. But even if you have to go by that, there is a constitutional arrangement at resolving a contradiction, at resolving
a
problem.
So the wars in this region are at a failure to resolve these contradictions.
Yes, because we don't follow the rules we ourselves set, and we think because we have arms, we should dominate the ground, and there is an attempt at the oppressed, at the exploited.
Where is the role of foreign interests?
You see, foreign interests cannot dominate you unless they take advantage of your own internal weaknesses. I gave you an example that those who root Ugandans, those who manage Ugandans and root them, take the swag to other countries. But those who have rooted South Sudan bring their swag to Uganda, to Muyeng. You get it. So all the mindset of leaders that on assuming state power, you must root. And you find someone is on the stock exchange, is too rich, is on world stock exchange, but at the same time he wants to manage a border. He's fighting people in the slums because he wants their land. But they are even in supply of fake drugs. So it's a sickness. People are sick.
Viewers, I'll take a short break. When I return from the break, it certainly will be joined by Colonel Felix Kulaije. But as we came on the show, Dr. Arthur Wainomugisha said he was a peace general. His business is making peace. And Arthur, in answering this question, why war? Why can't we make peace? At least starting with this region, because it's been expanding. We thought we had seen the best and worst of wars, and we were thinking of Zambia's, where, unfortunately, Mr. Scott is being chased from the political party for trying to make peace. The current acting president of Zambia, the president, is being chased from the political party. But there was a peaceful transition in Zambia. There was one in Malawi. Botswana has settled. Namibia is very decent. Ghana is...
But there was war there.
Yes. Ghana is a perfect reflection of democracy. Kenya has had hiccups, but you would still give them kudos for moving on. Tanzania will have a bit of Chivoko squad here and there, but at least their democracy is taking shape. Why not the rest of Africa? Why do we still have cases of Kampaore? Don't go away.